The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A good morning to one and all, and welcome to our online worship at Trinity Presbyterian in Raleigh. I trust you had a good day with your family, even if it might have been somewhat abbreviated on Thanksgiving Day. I hope you were able to eat abundantly, and one of the great days of the year we could maybe overeat and not feel too guilty about it, because it is an act of thanksgiving for all the good gifts that God has given us from the fields and from the forests and the seas. So we welcome you this morning, especially if you are visiting, maybe for the first time. We hope that this service will give you some deeper insight into the love and grace and mercy of God, and will help you get through the week to come. So we hope you will join us again soon and often right here on this station. So let us now begin our worship today with the lighting of the first Advent candle.
We're the Bernardina family reading the first Advent, first Sunday of Advent.
The world says all is lost. God says all are loved.
Fear says cover your eyes and your ears. Hope says wait, watch, and listen. As we light our first Advent candle,
we pray for the holy hope of God.
You want to get down? Come now, O child of Mary.
Come now, O Prince of Hope.
Good morning. Welcome to worship on this first Sunday in Advent. We begin our service with our first hymn, Come, Thou Long-Expected Jesus. Jesus was announced by many prophets, and it was such a joy to know that he was coming. So let's sing together verses 1 and 2 of Come, Thou Long-Expected Jesus.
Advent is the season in the church year for waiting on and anticipating the coming of God's mercy in the Messiah, the Christ. We celebrate not only his first coming at Christmas, but of his promise to come again and make all things right and good. One of the titles for Jesus, of course, is Savior. Another is Deliverer, Prince of Peace, King of Kings. And so as we remember this great promise of God to forgive sins and to make all relationships right throughout the world, even with God, our Creator Himself, let us now join together in the unison prayer of confession, to be followed by a moment of silent and individual confession. Let us pray together. Restore us, O God of hosts. Let your face shine, that we may be saved. Save us, O Lord, from the traps of our own creating, from fear that blocks the way of love, from worry that blocks the way of joy, from isolation that blocks the way of relationships, from structural injustices that keep the world bound. Forgive us, O God of hosts, until the stars fall from heaven and we live as people transformed. Hear our prayers, O Lord, both spoken and silent. In the name of Christ, we pray. Amen. And now may the peace of Christ that passes all understanding be with you now and forever, and also with you.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination. Living God, help us so to hear your holy word that we may truly understand, that understanding we may believe, and believing we may follow in all faithfulness and obedience, seeking your honor and glory in all that we do, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The first scripture lesson today comes from the book of Isaiah, chapter 64, verses 1 through 9. Listen for the word of the Lord. Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down, that the mountains would tremble before you. As when fire sets twigs ablaze and causes water to boil, come down to make your name known to your enemies and cause the nations to quake before you. For when you did awesome things that we did not expect, you came down and the mountains trembled before you. Since ancient times, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, who acts on behalf of those who wait for him. You come to the help of those who gladly do right, who remember your ways. But when we continued to sin against them, you were angry. How then can we be saved? All of us have become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous acts are like filthy rags. We all shrivel up like a leaf, and like the wind, our sins sweep us away. No one calls on your name or strives to lay hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have given us over to our sins. Yet you, Lord, are our Father. We are the clay, you are the potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be angry beyond measure, Lord. Do not remember our sins forever. Oh, look on us, we pray, for we are all your people. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
There are some Christmas carols that don't seem to get sung nearly enough. And one of my favorites talks about the angel Gabriel coming to visit Mary and announcing that she will be the mother of Jesus. So this is a picture song. As we sing, as I sing this song, make a picture in your head. There's Mary in her humble little home, probably baking bread or cleaning up. And she's just an ordinary girl, just an ordinary girl. And suddenly, the most wonderful thing happens. An angel comes from God and speaks to her. Make that picture in your head. There's Gabriel in all of his glory with his snow-white wings. And he gives her the best message in the entire world. She will be the mother of the Messiah. That had to be really scary, but at the same time, so wonderful. So make the picture in your head of Mary in her humble home and the angel coming and speaking to her. Listen, please.
His wings as drift generations praise continually. Your Son shall be Emmanuel, by seers foretold. Most highly favored Lady, Gloria. Then gentle Mary meekly bowed her head. To me be as it pleases God, she said. My soul shall laud and magnify God's holy name. Most highly favored Lady, Gloria. Of her Emmanuel the Christ was born, in Bethlehem all on a Christmas morn, and Christian folk throughout the world will ever say, most highly favored Lady, Gloria.
Good morning, boys and girls. I hope you're doing well. I hope you had a great time with your family on Thanksgiving Day and had plenty of turkey and dressing and sweet potatoes and all that good stuff, cranberry sauce. I have here a little turkey with me today, and they are beautiful birds, are they not? And my wife and daughter and I were walking the other day, and it was the day after Thanksgiving, I believe, and we heard a bunch of crows. You know, crows say, caw, caw, caw. And I turned to them and I said, you know what they're saying? You know what that means? And they said, no. I said, they're saying, thank God I'm not a turkey. Because we don't eat crow on Thanksgiving, and they were glad about that. But anyway, that's enough of that. I happen to be masquerading today as Governor William Bradford, who was the first governor of Plymouth, the Massachusetts Bay Colony, the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, it was eventually called. And they had the very first Thanksgiving on 1621. That's almost 400 years ago. They came over in 1620, but they didn't have their first harvest until the spring of, spring and then all the way through the fall in 1621. So when the last of the harvest came in, Governor Bradford called a big celebration, a three-day festival to thank God for their successful passage from England to the New World, and to thank God for the first corn crop, and to thank God for their new neighbors, the Massasoit Indians. We call them Native Americans now, because that's a long story behind that. But they sat down together. There were 50 pilgrims, they were called. And there were only 5 women there, I'm told, which is strange. But and 90 Native Americans joined them, and they had a wonderful time. Now, we think they probably ate turkey too, and we would be wrong. According to the historians, their menu was a little bit different. They lived right by the sea, and so seafood was plentiful. So let me read you the menu for the first Thanksgiving meal in 1621. They had duck, they had geese, some think they had swans. Of course, they had fish, lots of fish, lobsters, because they were very plentiful in that part of the world. Oysters, fish, and even eels. Yuck. But anyway, they didn't have the sweet potatoes like we do. They had pumpkins and other squash and cranberries. But they didn't have any refined sugar either, so they didn't make the sweet cranberry sauce that we make. But what a menu, though. They were so grateful, and they were celebrating God's grace to them. And did you know that in 1863, 200 years later, plus Sarah Joseph Hale, who happened to be famous for writing the poem Mary Had a Little Lamb. She had been writing to people in Washington for 17 years to have a national day, a holiday called Thanksgiving. Well, she finally convinced the President Abraham Lincoln to do so. And so in 1863, the month of October, he proclaimed that the last Thursday in the month would be a national day of Thanksgiving, and we're still doing it. Thanks be to God. Did you know that there are four towns in America called Turkey? That's the name of the town, Turkey. One of them happens to be right here in North Carolina, about an hour south of here near Clinton, and two of our members, Marge Wright and her late husband, Stan, were born and raised in the town of Turkey. Turkey was so much, became so much a part of American life that Benjamin Franklin, one of the founding founders of our nation, wanted the turkey to be the national bird instead of the eagle. Can you imagine seeing turkeys on flags and on public buildings everywhere you go? Anyway, that's just a little bit of trivia I thought you'd like to know. Izzy's excited. He's not a turkey. And he got excited about Advent and got dressed up with a purple stole. I've got my purple stole on. I've got on a purple tie. Look at this sea of purple. Do you know why Advent is purple in color? That's right. I thought you did. Purple is the color of kings, of royalty. And Jesus was the new king. The king in Hebrew means Messiah. And so we celebrate the coming of Jesus, sent by God to become the new king of God's kingdom, where there is only love and joy and peace and all those wonderful gifts. So I hope you had a great Thanksgiving day. We're excited about Advent. We're going to be lighting a candle every Sunday until we light the big Christ candle on Christmas Eve to celebrate the birth of Jesus, the coming of the Messiah. Hold hands with somebody close to you and let us pray. Please repeat after me. I don't like to pray with a hat on, so I will take it off. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, thank you for all that you give to us. Help us to share what you have given with others, and let us celebrate the birth of Jesus on Christmas Day. And let all God's people say together, Amen. Izzy says, so long. See you next week. Toward the end of his ministry, Jesus told his disciples that he would be leaving, but one day he would come again. And so this passage today deals with that second coming and has fascinated people down through the ages. So listen now, if you will, for the word of God in Mark chapter 13, verses 24 through 37. Jesus said, but in those days, after that suffering, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light. And the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. And then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near at the very gates. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day or hour, no one knows. Neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey When he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or at a cockcrow, or at dawn. Or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. A few years ago, I was driving through Alamance County, returning to Raleigh from a wonderful visit with my parents in Burlington. And I happened to see a billboard there off to my left that I'd never seen before, and it really blew me away. It announced the second coming of Christ was happening on May the 21st, 2011, just a few weeks from that moment. Well, my first reaction was shock, which quickly gave way to no small amount of skepticism, and then a little bit of relief, knowing that maybe I wasn't going to have to paint my house after all. But the Reverend Harold Camping, who had somehow deciphered the precise date, was not the first person to come up with a particular date. No, he marches at the back of a very long parade of prognosticators who had become convinced that they had somehow discovered the day and the hour of Jesus' return to earth. And of course, they were all wrong. We are still here. Reminds me of the old New Yorker cartoon with a prophet of doom wearing a burlap sack walking down Fifth Avenue with a big poster that read, "Doom, doom. The world is not going to end." Okay, enough of that. Bishop Clement of Rome was the first to arrive at a date, and it was 90 AD, only about 70 years after Jesus left. He was followed by Hilary of Pontus, who predicted the end in 365, followed by his student, Martin of Tours, who revised the date to 400. Then came the German Emperor, Otis III, who was convinced by a solar eclipse in 968 that was the year. We human beings love round numbers. So when the year 1000 AD rolled around, panic hit the church. They tried to beat the love of Christ into pagans in order to save as many as they could before the end. The Shakers signed on in 1792. Charles Wesley, the brother of John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, came up with the year 1794. The Jehovah's Witnesses came up with 1914, then 1915, again in 1918, 1920, 25, 41, 75, and the last time was 1994. You would think that people would have grown tired of doing this, but they haven't. Well, you know, if they just asked me, I could have saved them a bunch of time and money and embarrassment by referring them to Jesus. He said, if you were paying attention to the second lesson this morning, no one knows the precise time when Jesus will come again, not even Jesus. So if you ask me, I think I'm going to stick with Jesus on this matter. If he doesn't know, I don't need to know. In our lesson today, Jesus didn't say when it's going to happen, but he does say what will happen at the end of history and time as we know it. The sun and the moon will be darkened. The stars will fall from the heavens. The powers of heaven will be shaken. And the Son of Man will come on the clouds with great power and glory. A good word for this kind of event would be cataclysmic or catastrophic. This will be quite a switch from his first coming, when he was born rather quietly in a stable.
with very little fanfare. Other than a choir of angels appearing to the shepherds as they lay asleeping and keeping their flock out in the countryside. So when they arrived in Bethlehem to check it out and pay their respects, about the only other sounds there were the lowing of cattle and the bleating of sheep and goats, with perhaps a few chickens running around. Chickens are always running around. Hardly the red carpet treatment one would expect for the birth of a new king. When you think about it, the world Jesus came to save and to change knew very little about his arrival until 30 years after the fact, when he put down his hammer and his chisel and began preaching about the kingdom of God, that's also called the kingdom of heaven, that was available to anyone who would receive it, whatever their station in life. Now, ordinarily, about this time of year, we start hearing those classic Christmas songs, like "It's the Most Wonderful Time of the Year." I always think of Johnny Mathis, his version, when I hear that song. Or "It's Beginning to Look a Lot Like Christmas." This year will be a little different, I'm afraid, because of COVID-19, which has become the Grinch that is about to steal Christmas. I am acutely aware of this, and I want you to know that I share your pain. The fact that we are not going to be able to celebrate and enjoy Christmas in the traditional ways that have marked the passing of time for us through the years, it's a big loss. And I think we should mourn that, but I do not think we should be stuck there. Let's try to look at it another way. Surely there's got to be a silver lining in there somewhere. I'm reminded of the little boy who was on top of a very tall pile of manure with a shovel in his hand, shoveling away left and right as fast as he could. When someone asked him what he was doing, he said, "Well, seems to me that with this much manure, there must be a pony inside there somewhere, and I'm going to find it." I like his optimism. Since the invention of Black Friday, which I'm sure a lot of people still think was a religious holiday, and sadly it has become a religious holiday for some, our culture has turned the month of December into one long shopping spree. And that has its merits, but it also has its downsides. Unfortunately, this has enabled our culture now to compete with Advent in a serious way that really crowds out the time available for doing things that really matter leading up to the celebration of the birth of Jesus. And believe me, and you won't, and this will come as no surprise to you, I certainly believe that the celebration of Advent, thinking about what it means that Christ came into the world 2,000 years ago and has promised to come again and make all things right, that seems to me far more significant than saving a little extra money and finding the perfect gift for someone who already has most of everything. When I started my ministry 45 years ago, people spent a lot more time observing Advent traditions like Advent calendars, Advent wreaths at home, even special Advent Bible studies at church. So maybe since we will not be spending so much time this year at the mall or at restaurants or at Christmas parties, maybe we can spend a little more time on the softer side of December, the spiritual side. Now, don't get me wrong. Scripture, life experience, and good old-fashioned reason have revealed to us that God created human beings with both a physical and a spiritual side. A common fallacy holds that the physical side is bad, evil, and the spiritual side is good. The Greeks certainly believed that 2,500 years ago. They understood the spiritual side of the human life was held captive by the physical, material side. And the ultimate liberation came when the body died and freed the spirit to realize its highest potential, to be done with that evil flesh. Well, nothing could be farther from the truth for Christians whose house is built on the foundation of Hebrew theology. The book of Genesis clearly states right in the beginning that God created the earth and the universe and all that was within them. And at the end of each day, God looked around at the material world God had just created and saw that it was good. Okay? Of course, God's crowning work came on the last day when he created human beings. We had a body, a mind, a heart, and a soul. And the freedom to love and to receive love. Living in loving, wonderful relationships with our Creator and with one another. And at the end of that last day, God looked around at everything he had made, and behold, the text says, it was very good. Not just good, but very good. Tov me'ov in Hebrew. So from the very beginning, the biblical view of the material world was very high. God created it. Psalm 8 asks, what are human beings that God is mindful of them? God has created them a little bit lower than God. Some translations say lower than the angels, and crowned them with glory and honor. That's a pretty high view of humanity. A lot higher than the medieval and Puritan view that human beings are totally depraved after the fall. And so much so that there is no good in us. Of course, the Bible also reveals that human beings were not content with being a little lower than God or the angels. So Adam and Eve rebelled against the order of things, the created order of things, and went their own way, wanting to be like God. But if their fall, I ask you, was to the very bottom of the well, making them utterly incapable of doing any good, then it seems to me that all the reports in the Old Testament about righteous, loving, selfless deeds are false. Think about that. It seems to me a better understanding of humanity standing before God after the fall is that we are a mixed bag. Capable of both good and evil. Capable of loving or being self-centered. Nevertheless, the main point to be made is that no matter how good we might be, no matter how many good deeds we might perform, Paul was right when he said all people have sinned and fallen short of the will of God. Which is another way of saying that we do not earn our salvation or acceptance by God by anything we do, because we cannot earn it. We cannot be perfect. And so we always, in the Christian's faith, fall back on God's grace. Our salvation, our acceptance, is based upon God's mercy and his unconditional love. And that brings, it seems to me, us to two very theologically important holidays, occurring in the same week, mind you, Thanksgiving and the first Sunday of Advent. If our standing before and with God is determined by God's grace and mercy alone, in other words, a completely undeserved and unearned gift, then the appropriate response to this wonderful gift is faith. And faith is not only believing it to be true with our minds, but also accepting it with our hearts and our soul. That's why Paul Tillich defined faith as accepting God's acceptance of us. The divine acceptance precedes our acceptance. We just simply receive the gift. And we call the net result of this process salvation or redemption, or this whole new life that God has given us in this wonderful world, which leads to reconciliation with God and us and even amongst us with those we don't get along with. So, if God has given us so much, surely that ought to make any sensible person grateful. If you read the book of Psalms, you will be bowled over by how many times the words praise and thanksgiving occur. Hundreds. Because that is the set point, the basic reason that God's people go into the temple is to give thanks to God and praise God's holy name for this incredible gift of deliverance, of salvation, of redemption. After all, Israel as a nation began in the grand liberation of God taking his people out of Egyptian slavery and taking them to a promised land, a land of freedom. So as you enjoyed your big meal on Thursday with your family and friends, even if it might have been a lot smaller this year than we would have liked, I hope that you did so in the spirit of humble thanksgiving to God for all that we have, not in the spirit of just plain old self-indulgence, although that's not bad either in moderation. Both Thanksgiving Day and Advent are about giving thanks to God for God's amazing and generous gift to us. In a moment, we are going to gather in a socially distant way around our Lord's table for another meal. This one will not have nearly as many calories, but it will be spiritually nourishing in a way that I cannot even explain. It can only be experienced. We Christians have really never known what to call this meal. Some of us call it the Lord's Supper. Others call it communion or Holy Communion or the Sacrament of Communion. The Episcopal Church, I think, has the best name for it. They call it the Eucharist. That is Greek for thanksgiving, giving thanks to God for the gift that God has given us in Christ. At about 8 o'clock on Friday evening, the day before I recorded this sermon, the sermon didn't have an ending. I'd gotten kind of busy around the house helping out with the preparation of the food and all the requirements regarding that, even though there are only three of us this year. And so as I sat down to write my ending late in the day on Friday, I got a text, as I am inclined to do, from my good friend Tom Kerrigan, who loves to send me religious cartoons that are just unbelievable. They usually make a great theological point with and put a smile on your face at the same time. It was a wonderful paraphrase of 1 Corinthians 13, the love chapter in Paul's letter to the church in Corinth. And so I think the best way to end this sermon this morning is just read it to you. I think it hits a grand slam home run on the true meaning of Advent and Christmas, on how we should get ready to celebrate the greatest day of the year, the birth of the Messiah. Here it is. I don't know who wrote it. It was not signed. If I decorate my house with perfectly plaid bows, strands of twinkling lights and shiny balls, but do not show my family love, I'm just another decorator. If I work hard in the kitchen, baking dozens of Christmas cookies, preparing gourmet meals, and arranging a beautifully adorned table at mealtime, but do not show love to my family, I'm another cook. If I work at the soup kitchen or sing carols in the nursing home and give all that I have to charity but do not show love to my family, it profits me nothing. If I trim the tree with shimmering angels and crocheted snowflakes, attend a myriad of holiday parties and sing in the choir's cantata, but do not focus on those I love the most, I have missed the point. In other words, love stops the cooking to hug a child. Love sets aside the decorating to kiss the spouse. Love is kind, though harried and tired, certainly at this time of year. Love doesn't envy another's home that has coordinated Christmas china and table linens. Love doesn't yell at the kids to get out of the way, but is thankful that they're there to be in the way. Love doesn't give only to those who are able to give in return, but rejoices in giving to those who cannot. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. Video games will break. Pearl necklaces will be lost. Golf clubs will rust. But the gift of love will endure forever. Can I get an amen to that? Thank you, Tom, and whoever wrote this. Let's get ready now to gather at our Lord's table virtually to give thanks for all that God has given us through Jesus Christ, to celebrate the Eucharist, the greatest Thanksgiving meal of all time. Let us pray. Oh, loving God, prepare our hearts and minds now to take a seat at your Son's table, where we can feed upon these common elements taken from the earth that become, through the power of your mercy and grace for us, great spiritual gifts of forgiveness, of compassion and empathy for the whole of your creation. Oh, gracious God, help us to be still, if only for a moment, to listen for and to hear your word of grace to us all. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Please join me in stating what we believe through the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The time-honored spiritual discipline in the Christian church is stewardship. Giving back to God a portion of all that God has given us, including our time, our talent, and even our treasure. Because God is the source, the generous, loving source of all that we have. The session and I wish to thank you for your generosity through this difficult pandemic. We have been very grateful for that, and we have been grateful for all those who have sent in estimate of giving cards for next year's ministry and mission. We're gaining on it. There are still several out there. We hope you will send them in as soon as possible, if you are able. So again, we give you thanks for your great generosity. And the Apostle Paul always reminds us that we will be rewarded with great spiritual rewards for our generosity. Let us now ask God to bless these gifts and offerings and estimates of giving. Let us pray. Almighty God, we give you thanks for Jesus the Christ, the Savior of the world, the one who brings us this new life we enjoy in the great spiritual fellowship of the church and enables us to live in reconciled and healed relationships out in the world. Bless these gifts and offerings, O God, and the spirit and the intent with which they are given. We pray that you will use them to continue Christ's ministry of love and compassion and reconciliation here in our community and abroad in the world. And let all those who love you through Christ say together, Amen.
God from home, all
since this is our Lord's table, a table of grace, a table of mercy, a table of forgiveness. And because of Christ's life and his ministry and his death and resurrection, the risen Christ reigns with God, the Creator, now over all things, and eventually in a way that will make all things right and all things good. And great reconciliation will be the mark of God's kingdom. So I invite you to come to this table today, virtually at home. And if you don't have any bread or some form of juice at this point, now's a good time to kind of quickly head to the kitchen and get back as quickly as you can. We always begin Advent with the Sacrament of Communion. What better way to start this holy season of preparation for the celebration of Christmas? And if you haven't noticed lately, that word comes from the Christ. So I invite you to come today. Bring all that you have, all that you are, even the bad stuff, especially the bad stuff. Because here we can set it aside, lay it down at the foot of the cross, and be rid of it and done with it and given a whole new, fresh start. That is the beauty and the power of this sacrament. This sacrament is based upon the gifts of bread and wine, fruit of the vine, both common staples taken from God's good earth. But they represent a greater, invisible, inner reality called the peace of Christ, the new life in Christ that has the ability to heal our wounds and to forgive our sins and make us whole. So I invite you now, if you will join me in the call to prayer, the great prayer of thanksgiving, we call it, as we set apart these earthly elements for the holy use for which God has created them in this sacrament. So I hope you have your bulletin in front of you. I will say, the Lord be with you, and you will say also with you. I will say, lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. We give thanks to the Lord our God, and you will say, it is right to give our thanks and praise. Got it? The Lord be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. O gracious and loving God, we give you thanks that you created this world and the whole universe and formed us in your image and likeness and set us in this world to love and serve you. When we were captives in slavery, you delivered us to freedom and made covenant to be our sovereign God. When we were stubborn and stiff-necked, you spoke to us through prophets who looked for that day when justice would triumph and peace reign over all the earth. Therefore, we praise you today, joining our voices with the celestial choirs and with the faithful of every time and place who forever sing to the glory of your holy name. O God, when the time was right, you sent your Son, Jesus, into the world to bring freedom to the captives of sin and to establish justice for the oppressed. He came among us as one of us, taking the lot of the poor, sharing human suffering, dying an unjust death. We rejoice that in his dying and rising again, you set before us the sure promise of new life, the certain hope of a heavenly home where we will sit at table with Christ our Lord. Remembering your gracious acts in Christ, we take from your creation this bread and this wine and joyfully celebrate his dying and rising as we await the day of his coming.
With thanksgiving, we offer our very selves to you to be a living and holy sacrifice dedicated to your service. So, gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us today and upon these your gifts of bread and wine, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and the blood of Christ. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, that we may be one with all who share this feast, united in ministry in every place. As this bread is Christ's body broken for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. O God, we pray now for those who are hurting, especially those being so deeply affected by the coronavirus. As this new surge begins, we pray that you would strengthen the resolve and the performance of all those on the front lines who are battling this dread disease. We pray that you would give hope and strength and courage to those who are infected. And be with us all, O Lord, as we take the steps that we know that are right to shorten this pandemic, to save lives, and to prevent harm from so many more. Oh God, strengthen us in the power of your Holy Spirit to bring good news to the poor, to loose the chains that bind. Keep us faithful in your service until Christ comes in final victory, and we shall feast with all your saints in the joy of your eternal realm. Hear us now, O Lord, as we pray in the way Jesus taught us long ago, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. And let all God's people say, Amen. That night in the upper room in Jerusalem, Jesus took bread, and after he had blessed it, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, at the conclusion of the meal, Jesus took the cup, and after having given thanks to God for it, as we have done here today in his name, he gave the cup to his disciples, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood. All of you, drink of it. For as long as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you show forth the coming of the Lord. Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Let us take our bread or cracker or whatever you may have and dip it into your juice or liquid. And receive this great gift from God together. Let's now join together in the prayer following communion. We thank you, O God, that through word and sacrament you have given us your Son, who is the true bread from heaven and food of eternal life. Strengthen us in your service, that our daily living may show our thanks. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
As we begin the season to welcome our Lord at Christmas time, we sing our final hymn, Lift Up Your Heads, Ye Mighty Gates. Let's get ready to welcome the Lord.
Thank you for tuning in today to our virtual service. I hope you have a great turkey sandwich today for lunch and what's left over. Thank God for leftovers. We hope you'll tune in next week, the second Sunday of Advent, and help us light the second candle to light the way for the coming of a better day. So go out into the world in peace now. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return no one evil for evil. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Honor all people. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the great communion of the Christian Church through the Holy Spirit be with you and all those you love, now and forever. Let all God's people say, Amen.